Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
Give not that which is holy unto the dogs. So we don't know what the holy thing is there right now. Neither cast your pearls. We don't know what the holy thing, the pearls before swine, lest they trample them. Of course, there's a personal pronoun there, them, but it could be, we could argue and say, well, no, it could be talking about things there too. Okay, fine, I'll go there. Under their feet, and turn again and rend you. Well, who's he talking to? He's talking to people, right? So it seems to me that the holy ones and the pearls must also be people. Because he said by the time he's done with them, they're going to turn, that crowd right there, the swine and all, they're going to turn on you. Sounds like people to me. And as I said, much confusion has resulted from the misuse of this passage of Scripture. And what it generally is used for defies the very nature of God. Think about it. If it, and it's usually used in this sense, that it's used to cause us to withhold something of value from someone else. Can anybody quote John 3:16? For God so loved the world. What does God say about the world? He said, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. But God said, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. The most precious thing he gave to the low-down, rotten world. Now let's try to just rationalize that thought process with now he's telling us to hold back something. Remember what Paul said in Acts 20? He said, I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you. And yet people would have us believe that somehow we would be legitimate or we'd be within our rights to withhold something from the world, to withhold from these characters here something beneficial to them. And of course, the common interpretation of the passage is that it's wrong to preach the gospel. It's wrong to preach the gospel or provide any Bible principle to dogs and swine. But dogs and swine being interpreted as things like prison inmates, child molesters, homosexuals, people that make fun of the Bible, I mean, all of those kinds of things. Those are the people that we're supposed to be within our rights to withhold something like the gospel from them. I'm not telling you, stinking heathen. I have seen that in talking with individuals who are hardline Calvinists. They don't spend a whole lot of time preaching the gospel to anybody. Because to them, there's no point in it. Because God's going to save who's going to save. And he's not, no matter what you do, he's not going to save a certain crowd. If you're not part of the elect, if you haven't been predestined to be saved, then that kind of attitude stinks in the nostrils of God. Amen. And not only is it bad exegesis, it is clearly wicked in its intent. Because believe me, the difference when we say that for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. When you look at the holiness and the righteousness of Almighty God and the best that we have to offer, there's such a difference between us that if God held to this attitude, we'd still all be lost and on our way to hell. That attitude's more wicked than purgatory. Look with me in 2 Peter chapter number 2. 2 Peter chapter number 2 and verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. Here we find two classes of apostates. We find them listed as false prophets and false teachers. Kind of the same thing that we see if we go back to Matthew chapter number 7. In Matthew chapter number 7 and verse 15, of course there's a little interlude between what we were reading earlier and what we're about to read. I really do love Matthew 7, 13 and 14, because I like to tell people this, you know, most of the world does believe that the majority of folks are going to go to heaven, and only that wicked select few are going to go to hell. Well, not according to Jesus. And if you had a red letter edition of the Bible, you'd find these words in red letters, which means that Jesus actually spoke them. So right out of the mouth of the Son of God, he said, "Enter ye in at the straight gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And," next word, "many there be which go in thereat." He said, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. So if you just take Jesus at his word, he said, you know, most people are going to go that broad way, and they're going to destruction, they're going to go to hell. He said, and only a few folks are going to find the way of life. And there usually is that kind of a hush. Hey, 2 Peter 3:9, God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's not God's intent for that to take place. As a matter of fact, God didn't want any of us to go to hell. It was created for the devil and his angels. But what's he going to do with somebody that spits in the face of Jesus Christ and tramples underfoot the blood of the Holy One and counts it as an unclean thing? I submit to you tonight, he can't do anything else but send them to hell. But notice what it says there in verse 15, Matthew 7, 15. Beware, he said, of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Sounds to me like a stern warning that God has to mankind in general, and perhaps more specifically to his children, to be weary of false prophets and false teachers, because they're up to no good. They're like sheep in wolves' clothing. No, they're like wolves in sheep's clothing. Yeah. And no marvel, the Bible says, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. He has done that since he transformed himself back in the garden and pulled the wool over, or the snake skin, or whatever, over Eve's eyes. And it's been working ever since. Look also as he continues on. He says in verse 24, he said, we're in Matthew 7 again. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew. You get the context of everything that's being spoken of here? He's saying, look, I'm telling you something that is right, that is true, that you need to believe. He said, but there's a crowd out there that are going to do everything in their power to trip you up, to lead you astray. And he said, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell. Great was the fall of it. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And so the point he's making is watch out for individuals that are going to come along that are going to be false prophets or false teachers, and they're going to undermine the word of God. The most important thing we have, folks, is not only a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, but the very words of God in our hand. Let God be true and every man a liar. Now, when you think about it, the context of the chapter is false prophets and false teachers, and they're the very animals that we find in chapter 7, namely dogs and swine. He likens them to dogs and swine. Dogs and swine are unclean animals, right? They are. Aren't all unsaved people unclean? Well, why would you never be able to preach the gospel to the lost world? If all it's talking about is lost people, then how would we ever preach the gospel to anybody? If casting our pearls before them was to preach the gospel unto lost people, then who are we going to preach the gospel to? You don't preach the gospel to save people. Imagine how unloving and uncompassionate it would be to withhold the gospel from somebody. And yet, in religious circles, they do pretty much that kind of thing. Do you think that certain religions know that Ephesians 2:8 is in the Bible? Why don't they just tell people that? Why don't they say, you know, we were reading this week, I know we have all of these doctrines and all these programs and all of these, a whole litany of rules and regulations, but I was reading the other day. Wouldn't that be something if the Pope just came out and said, you know, I was reading the other day and I read Ephesians 2:8. It says, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. I failed to tell all of you that it's a gift of God. But I want everyone to know it's the gift of God. You're not going to hear that. But it is. Think about what it would be if you knew the truth and you didn't tell somebody. What do you think God would think about you? What did God think about Jonah? Remember in the story of Jonah, there was a whole city down there, and they were about to be destroyed. And God told Jonah to go down there and preach to them, and he did. Well, you know, it took a little while, and he had to go to Whale College first. He had a whale of a time. But after he got out, after he graduated, regurgitated, after he regurgitated from Whale College, God gave him the same commission again. He said, go down to Nineveh and preach the message that I've commanded thee. But this time, he did it. And when he did it, much to Jonah's dismay, they repented. They repented at the preaching of Jonah, an eight-word message. Yet 40 days and thou shalt be overthrown. That did the job. It wasn't a positive message, was it? It wasn't a loving message, was it? All of those that need to have the positive, loving message. When God sends a prophet to preach to lost people, he's not usually being very positive about it. Matter of fact, if you look at all of the preaching that was done by prophets, and judges. It was all negative. As a matter of fact, that's why they didn't like to see the prophet come to town. The prophet didn't always live in town, you know. And so when all of a sudden he came through the city gate, and it was like, oh, great. What are we going to hear now? What do you want? I remember I seem to recall reading an awful lot of the book of Jeremiah, where they loved him so much, they locked him up. Yeah. Did God appreciate Jonah's attitude? No. Matter of fact, he had to teach him in chapter 3 and 4, had to teach him a lesson about it. Now, it doesn't end on a positive note. We never know whether or not Jonah really got the message. But God delivered it to him. If I put it in the modern vernacular, what he basically said to Jonah was, how dare you? How dare you, you self-righteous slob? When I called you as a preacher to go and preach to a bunch of lost people, rather than do what I told you to do, you went running off to another country. And I had to hunt you down like a dog. And I finally got you, and it took a lot for you to finally come around and do what I told you. And then you get down there, and you have great success, success like most prophets never see in their whole ministry. And you go down there, and the whole place repents. And you want to sit on a hillside and wait for me to destroy them? You dog. I'm just filling in for God there. Aren't you glad God is God and I'm me? Remember, who invited him? What was God's attitude toward Peter in Acts chapter number 12? Arise, Peter, slay and eat. Not so, Lord. You're talking to a good pork-abstaining, Sabbath-keeping, temple-worshipping Jew here. I don't do those things. Was God pleased with him? Oh, that's right, Pete. I'm sorry. I forgot how religious you were. What did Jesus say in Mark 16:15? He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So then who are we supposed to withhold our pearls from? We haven't even defined what the pearls are. Although I've leaned in the direction of letting you know that it's got to be people. In Isaiah 55 and verse 11, Bible says, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Thankfully, God's word does that. In 2 Peter 2 and verse 22, but it happened unto them according to the true proverb. The dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. There's your dog and your swine again. And in the context of 2 Peter 2, we're talking about false prophets and false teachers. The male prophet and the female teacher. Notice how gender appears here. This was before we had transgender stuff. God doesn't believe in transgender. I remember reading in my Bible, Brother Steve, it said male and female created he them. Yeah. I bet God wouldn't erect a transgender sign on a bathroom. But it says there, but it happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. So it sounds like a male prophet and a female teacher. So when we apply this truth to the Sermon on the Mount, which we were reading in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, that's the Sermon on the Mount, which has absolutely nothing to do with church age doctrine, but nonetheless, a double truth emerges. If we can locate the pearls and that which is holy, then we'll know the correct interpretation of the passage. All we can do is figure that out. Well, the Holy Spirit connects pearls with the names of men in Revelation 21. In Revelation 21:12, he said, and speaking of the city walls there, the New Jerusalem, he said, and had a great wall and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. And down in verse 21, it says, and the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. And so even throughout the Old Testament, there are appears to be associations between precious stones and human beings. In Proverbs 31:10, who can find a virtuous woman? Why? For her price is far above rubies. In Proverbs 11 and verse 22, as a jewel of gold in a swine's snout. Every time I read that, I get a vision of it. So is a fair woman which is without discretion. In Malachi 3 and verse 17, the Bible says, and they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels and will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. Exodus 28 and verse 21, and the stone shall be with the names of the children of Israel, 12 according to their names, like the engravings of a signet. Every one with his name shall they be according to the 12 tribes. And so the true church, the body of Christ, which is composed of human beings, is called a pearl of great price in Matthew 13 and verse 46. If you want to turn over there for a second, he says in verse 46, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. That's exactly what Jesus Christ did with the church. We've been purchased with his own blood, according to Acts 20 and verse 28. He calls the church, the one that he purchased, the great, the pearl of great price, that pearl, that special, that gem that he chose to purchase is the church. And he purchased it, which the Bible says he sold all that he had and bought it. And of course, what God did was God gave the greatest thing that he had, which was his own precious son. And it says, take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood, in Acts 20 and verse 28. Ephesians 1:14 says, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 20, for ye are bought with a price, God said. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So God has purchased. He's purchased something precious. Matter of fact, he likens us to precious. And now, what about that which is holy? Well, think about it. Anything that belongs to God is holy. And in 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 14, the Bible says, for unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy. Holy doesn't always mean without any moral depravity. It just means that it's been separated. God called every article in the tabernacle holy. Now, was it made out of holy gold and holy silver? No, but it was holy. It was separated, purchased, designated for him and him alone. It was holy. And so in 1 Peter 1 and verse 15, but as ye, he which hath called you is holy, he said, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. God is holy. He wants us to be holy. Colossians 3:12, put on therefore as the elect of God, holy and beloved. That's how he describes us, holy and beloved. Ephesians 1:4, according as he hath chosen us in him from the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. And then final verse, 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 17, If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. So, who is it that is holy? We are. People are. The children of God are. The church of God is holy. Not only is it holy, but it is also precious. It is a precious stone. It is a precious gem. It is the pearl of great price. So what does the verse actually mean? The Bible is not saying that we're to refrain from presenting the gospel to less than desirable creatures. But rather, what it's saying is that it is wrong for us to turn over individuals, particularly for a preacher, to turn over someone that is has become a child of God and turn them over to false teachers and false prophets who will chew them up and spit them out and turn them into heathen themselves. That's what God is warning against. And it's so this idea of don't cast your pearls before swine, that means keep an eye on everyone and anyone that God allows you to have the privilege and leading to Christ. Paul called those individuals that he led to Christ his sons. He called Timothy my son in the faith. Now, was he really? No. But the care, the concern that he had for him was, these are one of mine, and we cannot afford to turn them over. And you can mark my words, if you've ever experienced this, you lead somebody to Christ, and you can almost say without, by the time the week is over, some cult, some goofball is going to try to lead them away. And if you let them go, that is casting your pearls before swine. And that is what God is warning us against. We can't allow something that is precious, something that is holy, to be discarded like an old rag.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc.com. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and you must be born again. Thank you for watching.